I think that individuals have to fight to prevent these acts of genocide from happening and then being forgotten.
We don't want this war to happen.
南京大屠杀是一场人类的浩劫。And I remember at that moment thinking to myself, this is one of the most powerful stories I've ever heard.
George Fitch, Christmas Eve, Nanking, China, 1937. I cannot rest until I have told it, and perhaps fortunately, I am one of a very few who are in a position to tell it. It is not complete, only a part of the whole. I believe it has no parallel in modern history.
这是2007年在全球公映的美国纪录影片《南京》中的片段。 这部纪录影片的导演是曾两次获得奥斯卡最佳纪录片奖的美国人比尔·古登塔格。Making
the film, my hope was we would show the worst and we would show the best. So it's the absolute worst side of humanity, and it's the best side of humanity. You're not just watching all of this horrible thing, you're also given this idea that there is some ray of hope, that in the darkest of times, that there is some light. So that's also part of what gives the story its great power, is this contrast between the worst of humanity and the best of humanity. All of us hope that we would be the people that would help.
2004年11月，美籍华裔作家张纯如自杀的消息吸引了一位美国媒体人的注意。他就是时任美国在线的副总裁泰德·莱昂西斯。In
fact, you know, I saw this obituary about Irish Chang. I read it and then I threw it in the garbage. And as I was walking by throughout the day, her picture was staring at me. And honestly, something motivated me to pull this obituary out of the garbage and bring it home with me. And I then became motivated to find out more about her.
接下来，泰德买来了张纯如的书，书中所讲述的故事。 让他大为震惊。封面上的那句“二战中被遗忘的大屠杀”，使他受到很大的触动。I
did not know about this time in history, and it struck me because on the book it talked about a forgotten Holocaust, and those were two words I had never seen put together. And so I was just very, very moved about the honor and bravery of the people of Nanking and the survivor stories, and became very motivated to tell the story.
泰德找到了好莱坞创新艺人经纪公司，请他们推荐一位导演协助自己拍摄一部关于南京大屠杀的纪录影片。经纪公司随后请来了纪录片导演比尔·古登塔格。
We seem to have a good relationship, and then I read the book, and then Ted said, "Well, do you want to make this film?" And when Ted said that to me, I said, "Sure, yes, I want to make the film."
And he said, "I don't know how we can tell a story because it's from the 1930s."
And I remember walking around the Stanford campus after I told Ted that I would want to do the film and saying, how do I do this film? How do I somehow bring it alive, bring the film into the 21st century and be true to the story? And I walked around this quad that they have at Stanford just trying to think about it. And out of that came up with the idea of using a combination of survivors and Japanese soldiers and also actors to tell the story using the real words.
比尔·古登塔格最终选择从留在南京建立安全区的那些西方人的视角去回顾1937年的那场人类劫难，而那些当事人都已经不在人世。比尔大胆使用好莱坞电影演员分别扮演那些历史人物，请他们朗读当年安全区人士的信件、日记和证词。
You know, the story is incredibly important, but just having an important story doesn't mean that people want to see it. So I was looking for a way in, a different way of telling the story. You know, one strand was the survivors telling their story. Another was the stock footage. Another was the Japanese stories. You know, some were still photographs, and other parts also involved the actors reading the true words.
这里是闻名遐迩的好莱坞比弗利山庄。让我们来看看，都是哪些演员在重现当年南京安全区的西方人。约尔根·普罗赫诺饰演西门子公司驻华代表、南京安全区国际委员会主席约翰·拉贝。伍迪·哈里森饰演金陵大学医院的外科医生罗伯特·威尔逊。马瑞尔·海明威饰演金陵女子文理学院教务主任明妮·魏特林。斯蒂芬·多尔夫饰演南京安全区国际委员会秘书斯麦斯博士。约翰·盖兹饰演南京基督教青年会秘书长乔治·费奇。
These characters fill your life, both the missionaries, the international community, and the Chinese people in the safety zone who took such care of everyone. It's a stunning story, and you hope that will live a story like that as a good example on the good side of everything that can be done.
I had not heard of the Rape of Nanking before making the film. And the poor people that suffered and, you know, living, you know, under this kind of fear, it was a really profound and very frightening story. I really found it to be, it really went into, got under my skin. I thought my character was really, it was a wonderful character to play because she was very, she was shifted by it. She was really changed and transformed by what had happened. I mean, who wouldn't be? Because I think when you witness that kind of atrocity that you're going to be affected.
And the hope was that an audience would watch and they would see, initially they would see Mariel Hemingway, but at some point they would forget that it's Mariel Hemingway and they would start thinking about her as Minnie Voltran. As time went you start out by seeing that they're actors, but you hope the audience will start forgetting that they're actors and that you start thinking, well, that's not Merrill Hemingway, that's Minnie Valtran. That's not Woody Harrelson, that's, you know, Robert Wilson, and so on and so forth. And so the idea was to have a more powerful connection with the audience.
Nanjing Shi Fan Da Xu是一所有着百年历史的学校。1937年的时候，叫金陵女子文理学院。明尼卫特林此时出任学校的教务主任。2014年8月，比尔·古登塔格应纪录片《1937南京记忆》摄制组的邀请，在这里与大学生举行了一场观影会。看到熟悉的法国梧桐和民国建筑，比尔有一种时光倒逝的感觉。虽然南京在这里拍摄已经是8年前的事了，但他对这座城市的记忆并没有消退。
Thank you everyone for coming here. Extremely grateful that you have come. I've had the good fortune to show this film all over the world, but I think no place is as special as right here, because every day you are walking through the same buildings and beneath the same trees as the events that you see in this film. And one of the reasons we made this film was that the story would live on to future generations and younger generations such as yourself.
比尔·古登塔格特别邀请了记录影片《南京》中采访过的大屠杀幸存者常志强来到现场。作为历史的当事人，他再一次见证了这座城市对于记忆的传承。
我母亲抱着我的丁小的弟弟，小弟弟拼命的哭，妈妈就给他起来，叫他不要哭。就在这个时候，那个日本鬼子扎了刺刀，一刺刀戳到我母亲，就把我母亲倒下来了。鬼子把这个刺刀拔出去以后，又一刺刀戳到我母亲，我母亲倒脚还倒下来，把我弟弟摔在地下了。我妈妈拼命的挣扎，把手撑起来，把衣服拽，拽坏里面的衣服，把瘤子盖回来，拼命的拽，拽回来，给我弟弟起来。结果弟弟呢，看到我妈妈把衣服拽回来以后，拼命跑，跑到妈妈怀里给她起来。我妈妈把衣服拽过来以后，我看了几个刀伤，都在流血。我弟弟在起来，靠母亲来着，变成一个刀伤里的汗毛血泡泡。我弟弟不懂事，拼命在起来，血泡泡动。我就赶快上去，我妈妈跟你捂着。我说你坚持一会儿，坚持一会儿，会好的。妈妈替你捂着，可是我妈妈不能讲话，眼泪直掉。
And I remember at that moment thinking to myself, this is one of the most powerful stories I've ever heard, that the translators were crying so hard that they couldn't continue translating. And then, you know, later, you know, a minute or two later, they came back and then they translated the story. And at that moment, those of us who were listening on translation, at that moment, I heard the story and I started crying and I looked over at the camera person and the camera person was crying. And, you know, we were all touched by this. And it was very, very powerful. My job is to maintain this power throughout the editing process and into the film.
比尔相信，有时候也许现实的残酷远比希望来得强大，但是永远都不要放弃对希望的信念。
And I have a question. So, what was it like for you to watch the film knowing that just outside the door all these events were taking place?
门外就发生着之前这个历史的事件，而现在我们坐在这个厅里，看到眼前绿树葱葱， 很难想象之前发生过这样的故事。
我是一个南京人，所以呢，对于南京大屠杀这段历史，我对于他的苦难和仇恨会感受很深。
为了收集到电影中的那些珍贵影像资料，记录影片南京剧组成立了一支40人的团队，成员来自世界各地，其中很多人都是历史研究方面的专家。
We wanted to create a film that would be completely defensible. You know, part of, you know, the issue around Nanking is that there are people who deny it or diminish it. They say it didn't happen or it didn't happen to the extent that the Chinese say it happened, and they'll attack the film. Well, we wanted to have a film that you couldn't really attack for its facts, that you could say everything that was in there was accurate and provable, and we were concerned about getting it right when we finally did it.
We tried to be meticulous in our research. It took almost 3 years to do all of the research and the shooting all over the world, and it stood the test of time. It became a highly awarded and decorated film.
比尔·古登塔格和投资人泰德·莱昂西斯尽了最大的努力来拍摄反映南京大屠杀的电影。他们希望这部电影能让全世界想看到它的观众都可以看到。然而，记录影片《南京》至今未能在日本放映。
We were not looking to make an anti-Japanese film. We were looking to make an anti-war film.
As I noted, I'm not Japanese. I'm not Chinese. I wasn't taking a side. We wanted to make a movie, and we wanted to tell a story of war and what the price of war.
Every festival we entered in Japan turned us down. And what we were told was that it's an unusual situation in Japan, so the film never played there. But also addressing the Japanese, I think it's really important to recognize the people who did this.
For the Nanjing massacre of Nanjing, Bier thinks他只是一名接力者。事实上，在互联网发达的今天，能够提供南京大屠杀西方视角的电影，不仅仅只有记录影片《南京》这一部。自1997年张纯如的书在美国出版之后，来到中国南京报道拍摄这一题材的媒体络绎不绝。他们对这一尘封的大屠杀历史以及留在南京安全区的西方救助者投入了足够的关注。仅仅是2006年年底，侵华日军南京大屠杀遇难同胞纪念馆就接待了多个摄制组，这其中有加拿大抗日战争史实维护会拍摄的纪录片《张纯如》，法国罗森电影公司拍摄的故事片《南京1937至2007》，也有比尔·古登塔格拍摄的纪录影片《南京》。他们试图用更加独特的视角来反映这段残酷的人类历史。比尔为拍摄《南京》收集史料时了解到，美国社会早在1937年大屠杀刚发生时，就率先报道过南京大屠杀。日军刚刚占领南京时，留在南京的西方记者有《纽约时报》的德丁，芝加哥《每日新闻》的斯蒂尔，路透社的史密斯，美联社的麦克丹尼尔四位记者，和派拉蒙影片公司的摄影师孟肯。 他们大多是在1937年12月15日乘坐瓦湖号炮艇从长江上离开南京到上海的。其中麦克丹尼尔晚走了一天，当他前往下关码头时，看到路边堆着几英尺厚的尸体，成千名中国男子排着队被集体枪杀。记者们离开南京时，日军对其做了严格的检查，禁止他们将拍摄的照片携带出境，竭力阻止日军暴行的外泄。但他们离开南京后，立即向世界做了报道。关于德丁的报道有这样一个插曲，当时在长江的一艘英国小炮艇瓦湖号上，几个西方记者把他们所见的血腥场面写成快讯，通过电报机传向了全世界。为了抢新闻，德丁本来是可以最快发稿的，他第一个跑到电报室请求电报员帮他发新闻，可是因为他最年轻又没有小费，人家不给他发。倒是斯蒂尔将小费悄悄塞给了发报员，于是第一份以日军杀人1万为题的电文通过长江上的炮艇传到了芝加哥每日新闻。由于时差的原因，报纸在12月15日刊登了他的报道，斯蒂尔实际上成了报道南京大屠杀的第一人。芝加哥每日新闻是一家上个世纪30年代在美国具有很大影响的报纸。摄制组拍摄到了1937年12月15日的这一份，在第3版右上方，标题为日军杀人1万的文章，尽管只有不到1000个单词，但是对于南京大屠杀这一世界近代史上的重大事件来说，却有着特殊的意义。这是西方媒体最早关于这一事件的报道。美国记者德丁在上海拍发的消息，俘虏全遭杀害，日军在南京的暴行扩大，一般平民亦遭屠，美国大使馆遭袭击，12月18日赫然刊登在《纽约时报》上，产生了很大影响。当南京大屠杀正在进行的时候，一位在南京生活了20多年的美国牧师约翰·马吉，用他自己的家用16毫米摄影机悄悄地记录下他所看到的一切。马吉牧师在影片的引言中写道，必须小心谨慎地行动，摄影时千万不可让日本人看见。在他拍摄的这些镜头中，城内到处是残垣断壁，受日军奸淫的中国妇女，被汽油烧焦的尸体，街道上、水塘中，到处是被日军血腥屠杀的平民。70年后，这些珍贵的影像被导演比尔·古登塔格使用在记录影片《南京》中，仍然令人震撼。
When people look at this and they see that there's been hundreds of thousands of deaths, well, that's not a number. That is somebody's life. That is a person who lived through this. So I think we're trying to put faces behind the numbers.
几位烧得面目焦黑、身体受到严重损毁的男子，日本兵本打算将他们活活烧死。一位搪瓷店职员的头部被日本兵用军刀严重砍伤，入院六天后，他的脑部的脉搏跳动依然清晰可见。还有一位遭日军轮奸的受害者，他的脑袋几乎被日本士兵砍掉。这些影像还包括一些受害者的惨状，其中就有南京大屠杀幸存者夏淑琴家中的镜头。2014年夏天，比尔古登塔格陪着夏淑琴专门来到侵华日军南京大屠杀遇难同胞纪念馆。
但是一家人一户就被他杀死了，就等他死后就等了十天，就没死掉。
14天在亲人尸体当中待了14天。
多少次人家来叫我带来看这个房子，我就不肯下来，我心里非常难过。
当镜头中出现那位指认裹着白布尸体的悲痛老人时，夏淑琴的眼泪又一次流淌了下来。
日本人进来的时候，当时连刀我3刀，但是我又死过了。当时我醒的时候，看到我妈妈就睡在桌子外的，衣裳一起扒掉了，我的小妹妹就死在院子里头，我姐姐呢又衣裳都没有，也不晓得给她盖，不知道就这样的。后来我们出来，瑶瑶这个也不活，瑶瑶那个也不活，没得一个活人了。
夏淑琴带着比尔古登塔格来到当年惨案的发生地老门东。
改变了，看这汽车也走不进去，那时候那个路就一般，就一般，汽车也走不进去。
哦，那边是两边都有房子吗？
啊，对，现在是改变了，都可能找不到了，都。
嗯。
在当年马吉牧师拍摄的受难者中，大部分人悲惨地死去，只有小部分幸运地活了下来。这段画面是马吉牧师所拍摄的4卷胶片中的其中一段。画面上的难民正在抬着大屠杀当中受伤的幸存者去一座小医院救治。这座医院究竟在哪里？长期以来一直得不到证实。戴元之长期研究南京大屠杀期间江南水泥厂设立难民营的相关情况。
1938年的2月16号，由丹麦人这个辛德贝格开车，接那个约翰马吉来到江南水泥厂考察。那么马吉就看到拍下了这样的镜头，村里面的老百姓抬着大屠杀当中死里逃生的伤员来到江南水泥厂。那么这么样一个背景在什么地方呢？现在我们找着了，那就是江南水泥厂当年的那个员工的一个俱乐部，就是现在这个的2层小黄楼。约翰马吉就是以他为背景拍下了这么一个画面。那么这张照片呢，那一个护士正在给一个由妈妈抱着的被烧伤的孩子在换药，是这么一个场景。我们大家注意到，这是这一个走廊，这儿又是廊柱。廊柱下面的储石上面有明显的水泥嵌缝。那么这个在什么地方呢？我们大家看一下这个照片，跟这个廊柱的储石是不是一样的？
这座位于江南水泥厂内的简易卫生院，在大屠杀发生的数周内，在丹麦人辛德贝格 和德国人金特的竭力保护下，就像汪洋大海中的一座孤岛，成为江南水泥厂附近难民的庇护所。这位叫苏国宝的老人当年只有10岁，他还记得在难民营里曾经见到辛德贝格的情景。
大古人是红头发，他人类倒不怎么样，这个胖。德国的那个警探他的脸胡子又毛拉拉的，蛮胖的啊。这几个给我了给我一块钱，我是表示感谢他们啊，救命之恩。当时一块钱能买到100多斤米，说的救了我一家，所以在那个真正的烧的火了，雪上加霜，那个艰苦啊，生活，亏了他们救了我。
辛德贝格曾经做过摄影助理，他用自己的相机拍下了很多江南水泥厂附近遭日军杀害的死难百姓的照片。这些照片被命名为辛德贝格相册，收藏于美国德克萨斯大学奥斯汀分校档案馆。1938年3月，辛德贝格离开南京，取道瑞士回国。在日内瓦，他遇见了出席第24届国际劳工大会的中国代表团。团长朱学范邀请他为与会的各国代表和记者100多人放映了马吉牧师拍摄的影片。
电影放映的时候，辛德贝格坚决地让妇女和儿童离开，说这个影片当中有好多是比较残暴的，这些观众是不宜在场的。那么辛德贝格一边放映一边做了解说。那么这个情景由辛德贝格做编辑的父亲都记录下来了，记录下来以后就发表在丹麦的澳洲新闻周报。那么电影放映完了以后，朱学范先生要来了辛德贝格的护照。那么在辛德贝格的护照上有一个题字，上面写辛佩先生中国挚友，对，称赞辛德贝格先生是中国人民的朋友了。
辛德贝格这个当年只有26岁的年轻人，凭借着巨大的勇气和德国人金特一起，在南京郊外的江南水泥厂难民营救助了20000多名难民。被救助的难民辗转送给他一面锦旗，上面绣着今天中国人再熟悉不过的4个大字：见义勇为。2006年4月25日，辛德贝格的外甥女玛丽安来南京时，将这件珍贵的文物捐赠给了侵华日军南京大屠杀遇难同胞纪念馆。2014年4月27日，丹麦女王玛格丽特二世来到侵华日军南京大屠杀遇难同胞纪念馆参观。这是纪念馆接待的首位现任的外国国家元首。在纪念馆的和平广场上，女王和她的丈夫一同为中丹和平树培土浇水，并亲手插上了一支永远的南京辛德贝格黄玫瑰。美国田纳西州首府纳什维尔，这座普通的教堂建筑是美国基督教会档案馆所在地。朱晓玲牧师，美国基督会，美国加拿大联合基督教会世界事工部亚太执行干事。一次偶然的机会， 朱牧师发现，记录影片《南京》中所讲述的大部分西方传教士档案，都静静地沉睡在这里。
基督会的档案馆，在这个档案馆里面呢，我们存了有许多档案，这些档案包括中国的档案，也包括这个南京大屠杀期间的一部分档案，像我们的传教士啊，魏特林啊，裴瑞德啊，还有贝兹啊。等我来。
如同在黑暗的隧道中穿行，长久以来，关于南京大屠杀期间留在南京救助难民的西方人的故事，都埋藏于浩如烟海的资料和档案之中。
你看这么多老照片，我们从库房里的拿出来，这是南京的记忆，这也是中国人民的记忆，这也是全世界人民的记忆。你看这张照片，五个护士抱着五个新生儿，家庭肯定是非常非常的高兴，这也是在战前。但是战争，南京大屠杀给他们带来的什么呢？带来的是医院变成了难民营，带来的是毁坏家园。
一张张泛黄的照片，记录了战争带给南京这座城市的创伤，也记录了大屠杀给人类记忆带来的无法抹去的悲痛。在比尔·古登塔格的记录影片《南京》中，基督教青年会秘书长乔治·费奇是重要的线索人物。他是1937年发生在南京的那场惨绝人寰的大屠杀中极少数的外国亲历者之一。哈佛大学校园内的燕京图书馆，这里以丰富的东亚文献收藏闻名于世。
这是我们在哈佛大学图书馆的档案室里面发现的乔治·费奇的个人档案。这部分档案是乔治·费奇的后人在他去世以后呢捐献给哈佛大学图书馆的，一共呢有54盒，那么每一个盒呢都基本上有这么大。那在这其中呢有很大一部分呢是关于南京大屠杀相关的档案，那么而且这批资料呢又一些部分呢而且是跟耶鲁的资料呢不重合的，应该说这对于我们南京大屠杀研究呢是一个很大的发现。
乔治·费奇这54箱档案文献的发现，又一次为南京大屠杀提供了新的铁证。
那这批档案里面我们目前看到的呢是乔治·费奇的那有关南京大屠杀相关的一些资料，它包括个人的记述以及他收集的当时所在南京见到的一些场景。这是当时1938年的那个South China Morning Post 的报纸当中的一些报道。那么大家看，在这个报道当中，The Rape of Nanking， 也就是说当时在1938年的3月份，就是对于南京大屠杀就已经以这样的一个名字为世人所广知。
在这批资料档案之中，费奇写给家人的信件里，他常常提到一个地点，南京鼓楼医院。南京鼓楼医院建于1892年，作为见证南京大屠杀这一历史事件的地标，是当时南京安全区内唯一的医疗机构。比尔·古登塔格来到这里寻找历史的细节。 在那个异常寒冷的冬天，医院的绝大多数医护人员都已经撤离，只有少数医护人员冒着生命危险留下来帮助灾难中的南京百姓。作为全城当时唯一的外科医生，罗伯特·威尔逊就是其中之一。在六周的浩劫中，他从死神的手上抢救下了无数南京的难民。人们从马吉牧师的影片中能够看到这令人感动的一幕。威尔逊，美国人，生在南京，毕业于普林斯顿大学，并在哈佛医学院获博士学位。31岁的威尔逊送走妻子和刚出生不久的女儿，自己坚决地留了下来。12月18日，他在写给妻子的信中说，今天是当代但丁炼狱的第六天，是用血腥和淫秽的大字写成的。大批人被屠杀，成千上万妇女被强奸。19日，他又写道，穷人的食物都被抢光了，他们处于歇斯底里的惊恐之中，何时是尽头？和威尔逊医生同样留在南京的还有特里莫医生、海因茨护士以及医院的化验室主任鲍恩典。1937南京记忆摄制组来到美国马里兰州的巴尔的摩，走进了鲍恩典女士外甥威廉姆的家。由于鲍恩典没有后人，他生前所有的家中物品都由外甥威廉姆继承和保管。在这里，随处可以见到来自中国的元素，从玄关处的民国瓷碗，到桌上的中式古典梳妆盒，再到墙上挂的苏绣和云锦，无不透露出这家主人和南京有着密切而深厚的关系。
We're so proud of her and grateful that she was the kind of person she was that wanted to give herself. I think the embassy asked the Americans to leave, and she, along with this other 19, 20 Westerners, were among those who stayed.
威廉姆·瑞恩一家至今都保存着当年被鲍恩典救助过的南京人民送给他的一面锦旗，上面绣着"慈善为怀"四个大字，以及他战时从南京鼓楼医院写给美国家人的信和日军占领南京期间的日记。
There are so many things that she says, and she dearly loved the people of China. And her reports on it and her writings are living proof and are a valuable addition to the diaries of others who have been published and talked about. So we're very proud that.What she did and who she was and what she wrote can share in keeping this story alive for future generations. We know it's done it for our children and grandchildren, and we're happy about that.
在鼓楼医院的医生护士们竭尽全力救助南京难民的时候，危险始终伴随着他们左右。透过硝烟过后的生死场，在南京这部影片里，既能看到日军犯下的滔天罪行，也能看到冒着生命危险去帮助别人的人。 即使在最黑暗的时刻，依然可以感受到人类的善良和美德。记录影片《南京》先后在美国、德国、中国等国家上映，引起巨大反响。西方媒体把这部影片与斯皮尔伯格当年拍摄的《辛德勒名单》相提并论。《纽约时报》刊文称，记录影片《南京》为发生在南京的惨剧提供了有力的证据。《华盛顿邮报》对记录影片《南京》的制片人泰德·莱昂西斯进行了独家专访，甚至日本的《产经新闻》在2006年11月26日头版头条刊文《美国拍摄反日电影》。
The Nanjing Massacre is an infamous example of an ultimate war crime.Taken out against the population with a conquering army. And the murders that took place, the rapes, they're well documented in terms of what happened to the innocent inhabitants and also others who were POWs, etc. One of an absolutely horrific crime.
You know, history is a strange business there.It's only real to the present day, to the extent that someone goes and finds it and pulls it back together and turns it into a story. Otherwise, it's just lost. People's memories aren't that good, and we don't live very long. So it has to be continually renewed from generation to generation.
We need to understand that it has power.So when situations start to rise up, where the negative part of humanity is being shown, then those who can remember the strength of love and the strength of caring need to be strong, because that love, that better side of human nature can prevail. So we learn to be strong in what we know is right.
Even now, the outside world knows very little about what happened in China during the Second World War period. People will have some awareness often of the Nanjing Massacre, the so-called Rape of Nanking, but even then their knowledge is not very great. So I think a documentary like this could do a great deal to educate people about this very important event and make sure that it's better known in the wider world.
记忆是一种对历史的传承，也是一种永不摒弃的情怀，同时它又是不容推卸的责任和警示未来的力量。南京大屠杀无疑是人类文明史上一场极为恶劣的暴行。在70多年后的今天，人们再次回望那场痛彻心扉的历史惨剧，并不是为了记住仇恨，而是为了警醒世人，避免重蹈覆辙。遗忘意味着背叛。只有正视历史，才能真正的面向未来。